Welcome back to the Nomiki Show. Thanks for sticking around. If you're not already, click like and subscribe on YouTube and make sure to share it. And of course, if you're not a patron, join us on patreon.com/the Nomiki Show. You are watching day three of our special DNC convention coverage, unconvention, virtual convention. It's all weird. I am so honored and so excited about our next guest. I would say she is probably one of the few people who has really gotten under Donald Trump's skin and taught him a lesson and beat him. Of course, I'm talking about Sara Nelson. Thank you for joining us. She's the president of the Association of Flight Attendants. It's a CWA union. And, you know, she's one of the badass trade union leaders in this country now that gives us hope. Thank you for joining us, Sara.
Happy to be here, especially with you.
Thank you. Man, I mean, there's so much to unpack here right now. I think progressives in particular, working people who are looking for some solutions right now in terms of everything. There are multiple crises happening at once. Healthcare being right in front of our faces, the rent crisis. Of course, there's student loans and there's economic crisis that I think we're all going to be facing, and the movement for Black Lives. So I wanted to ask you, I mean, you're a brilliant organizer. You've dealt with multiple crises. You've negotiated with Republicans. You've gotten what you've wanted, needed on behalf of your union. How do you see us in an a Biden administration moving forward, you know, as a movement? What do you think that we can bring to the table immediately after Biden is potentially inaugurated?
Okay, so first of all, I'm just going to say, you got to go vote for Joe. There's just no other option. I mean, this is not a normal election, right? It's every election is always the biggest election, blah, blah, blah. That's not what this is. This is either we have a democracy or we don't. And so everybody's just got to vote for Joe Biden. But moving on from that, there is no politician that's going to save us ever. Doesn't matter who they are. They don't exist, because the way that democracy works is if people actually engage in that democracy. And the way to engage people in that democracy is to have them thinking that their engagement actually matters. And the way to do that is to have a living, moving, breathing labor movement. Because people get results between elections when they're a part of a labor movement. You know, I know right now in this moment that the people that I represent are in better shape right now because our union is organized, because our industry is 80% union. That's about as close as you can get to any kind of sectoral bargaining. But we're 80% organized, and we pushed forward a plan. So we said when this crisis hit, first of all, we've seen crises before. We went through all the bankruptcies after 9/11. We know that there are people who just sit around, capitalists, who sit around and wait for the moment that crisis hits, because they know they can use that to their advantage. We know that the impending climate crisis, if we don't get engaged in this and actually lead for a solution, that the capitalists are going to take advantage of people being in such a desperate space that they get to have the solutions that work for them and take more money and more control from the people. So we got in right away and said, yes, there has to be relief, because without relief, our airlines are going into bankruptcy. And we know what happens when that happens. The workers lose, the consumers lose, everybody loses. You lose control of the process. Oh, and by the way, the bankruptcy court, like I learned at the end of the United bankruptcy, 38 months long in this bankruptcy.
Wow.
And as we were fighting at the end for our pensions, and the bankruptcy court judge says with one bang of the gavel that our pensions can be terminated, and with the next bang of the gavel that $400 million can be awarded to the top executives when $80 million would have saved our pensions, we know that the bankruptcy is no good. So we put forward a package that said, okay, yeah, the airlines need money, but who are the airlines? The airlines are the frontline workers. Oh, right. Who is America? It's the people of America, right? So we said, all right, it's got to be a workers first package. And this is going to go to payroll support. The airlines are going to be required to keep everyone on the job. They can only put the money towards people's paychecks and benefits. And as long as we have for-profit employer-based healthcare in this country, that's how people have healthcare in the middle of a pandemic. Right. So we kept people connected to their healthcare. And We also changed behavior on Wall Street too with this package, because we cut out stock buybacks and dividends and cut executive compensation. And I'm just going to give you one little tidbit here. 2 weeks ago on Squawk Box, they were squawking about the fact.
Show on CNBC.
CNBC. Yeah. They were squawking about the fact that the airlines actually had a gain in stock price, because there was some discussion about the 16 Republican senators who had signed the letter in support of extending our payroll support program. Never before in the history of Wall Street that I can remember has Wall Street ever bet for a company that's going to save jobs. Usually it's when they talk about layoffs that the stock price goes up, because they think, oh, more money coming back to the shareholders. Right. No, the program that was going to be extended to save jobs actually made the stock price increase by 10%. So this is something we hadn't thought about when we promoted this, but you can change the whole structure if unions are engaged and force a solution that's based on the workers not coming to the list with a list to the Biden administration saying, would you please pass these labor reforms? No, right. We're going to demand that actually we are central. So this idea that Biden is going to bring together a bunch of labor activists and talk about what we should do, we know what to do with the labor movement. He's got plans out the wazoo. He just needs to implement them. And the only way that's going to happen is if we organize and make him.
You just see power in a different way. And it's so refreshing, because I think so much of the movement is understanding how power dynamics work, when to demand, how to come to the table, not just with ideas and policy proposals, but really with your power and your force. The question, I mean, it's all over the internet. What's your perspective on this general strike? Because I would be, I would be yelled at basically by everybody if I didn't ask you about the general strike.
Well, you know, I mean, I suggested again that we need to plan for a general strike on election day. If we continue on and there is the continued destruction of the Postal Service, by the way, which started with George Bush. So let's be really clear. This is not like a new thing. But if our entire election process is going to be unraveled because the post office is dismantled, then we should call for a general strike on election day. But I will tell you this. So I did put that out there. We have to plan for a general strike all the time. Mm-hmm. And I just had the privilege. I probably shouldn't let this cat out of the bag, but Jane McAlevey and I had this discussion earlier today.
Oh, she's my favorite.
Yes. So Jane is setting up strike school training that is coming in just over a month. So people can look forward to that. But we're
virtual.
We're putting. Yeah, of course.
Oh, we have
course.
To. Have
everybody can participate about this in this. And I may be announcing this too soon. She's probably going to kill me. But anyway, it doesn't matter. It's never too soon to start talking.
She's a friend
about
of our show.
Preparation.
So.
OK, so anyway. So we need to be preparing for the general strike. And I think that thinking about around election day is a good thing to start thinking about. You know, what's so amazing about it is after I tweeted that, there's been several companies, related or unrelated, including Coca-Cola, that has been incredibly anti-union, who said they're letting their employees off for the day on election day. So there may even be corporations who get in on the deal here. But that's not the point. We need to build our power. We need to build our power. And I think you're seeing corporations get involved because of things like, you know, my U.S. passport is no good right now. I think, you know, if it were not for COVID, Americans aren't really thinking about these things. But we are not trusted around the world. We're going to lose our freedom. We are cut off from the rest of the world right now because our democracy is under attack so horribly, and because we are not acting like everybody thinks America is supposed to act. So everything is on the line, everything. And all of the American businesses are on the line too, and they're starting to get that a little bit. We as workers, though, can't let them co-opt our power. Our power isn't standing together.
What do you mean by co-opting our power?
So if Coca-Cola is seeing, oh, you know, this is a great example, actually. So if you were out during the Black Lives Matter protests and you saw all these corporations that have signs up that say Black Lives Matter, well, they had the signs up because they didn't want the windows smashed, right? They didn't have the signs up because they actually believe in Black Lives Matter. But they're co-opting the social movement. that's okay, because that means we're driving change.
Right.
We're driving them to change their behavior right in front of our eyes. That's from people getting in the streets. That's from people banding together. So you shouldn't dismiss that. I don't want to dismiss at all that Coca-Cola announced, oh, we're giving our employees the day off on election day. Let's grab it and own it. We made that happen.
Right.
Don't give them credit for that. Don't say that that's out of the goodness of their hearts. It's because they see where this is going.
Exactly.
They see that people are building up to a general strike. And what I said during the shutdown was that that thing was over like that, not because they were scared that all the airplanes were going to be on the ground, but that because they were scared that working people were going to taste our power. And once we get a taste of our power, we're never going back.
Oh, I love that. Taste our power. Put that on a t-shirt. Okay, so how is the airline industry doing right now? I mean, my mother is literally in the air right now flying to New York, and she said there were two people on her plane.
Yeah, so, you know, we've had stories about, oh, the airline industry is recovering. It's a little bit like, you know, the economy is going to recover if everybody just goes back to work. Well, yeah, great. No, the airline industry is 20% of what it was a year ago, and there is not... there is not a business anywhere that can operate on 20% of the revenue that it used to have. So here's the truth. United Airlines, Delta Airlines, American Airlines, Southwest, they're burning about $40 to $50 million a day. And so the government relief that happened, our payroll support, and then also they were given some government loans, that just stabilized them in March enough to go out then and get additional debt. But they're literally burning through that debt right now. So that means that at a certain point, we know when there's no rules anymore from Congress. So we're trying to get these rules extended. That hurt bounces back on the employees, right? Because the first place they come is for labor costs. And where we have contracts, we'll stand there with our arms crossed and refuse to give on our contracts. But the Delta Airlines, where there are very few unions, they can just cut pay, cut all the provisions tomorrow, and that starts the downward pressure. So the airline industry is not in a great place. We also are prohibited from taking American travelers to anywhere else in the world, and people are not flying domestically.
So American airlines are not allowed to
take American travelers to really anywhere else in the world. The crews that are traveling have the ability to work there, but then in a lot of cases they're having to just stay in their hotels when they get to these layovers overseas, and they can't go out because they have to quarantine. Yeah, so it's a completely different job, a completely different world to us. We're so used to, you know, we're used to really tasting freedom. Yeah. We have been able to fly to every corner of the earth when many people can only dream of crossing borders.
Yep.
And it's turned on its head right now.
What I understand about this in particular is you'd think that the airline industry in particular, Trump would be at least slightly responsive towards. Is he there? Like,
so who the hell knows? But
he's got to be hearing pressure from CEOs.
Sure. But I think also, you know, everybody's afraid to engage him because they don't know from one minute to the next where is he going to be. And actually, so part of the problem is that a lot of people have put so much importance there that they've forgotten, for example, that Congress can actually pass a law that's veto-proof, right? And you just sort of cut the president out of it. So that's what can happen. When the 16 Republican senators signed the letter that said they were in support of extending our payroll support, we got that done a week ago. We had a reporter ask Trump what he thought of that. And at that press conference, he said, oh, yeah, I think that's great. We should continue to support the airlines. You know, who the hell knows from one minute to the next? And his negotiators at the table have not been receptive to that. So.
Right.
So I think that we have to remember where our power lies. And if everyone would remember, everybody called that Trump's shutdown. If you go back and look, I didn't say his name one time. I said, Mitch McConnell can fix this today, over and over again.
Right.
And we just, you know, we have to think about actually where our power lies and where we need to put the pressure. In fact, by the way, just before I came on, I got a video of about 40 flight attendants who overnight showed up at Mark Rubio's office in Orlando just this morning. And they're out there chanting. It's so great. You know, they've got masks on, but they're out there chanting. They've got their homemade signs and they're like, get relief now. So, you know, we can still take action and we can hold these lawmakers responsible. And that's what we need to be doing. I know this is about the Democratic Convention. But,
No, but this is ultimately, I mean, the Democratic Convention has been an infomercial. I think we've talked about it enough, but it's really, you know, what we're trying to do in the show is figure out how we move forward. How do we, Trump in office or not, how do we, as what I still believe, and our last segment was a little divided, the panel was divided, but I believe is probably one of the strongest movements we've had, you know, in at least 100 years.
I think that's right, because I think that people are getting a taste of their power. Yes. And so you've seen these strikes happen and each strike builds upon another. And so people are starting to understand that, oh, we do have power in solidarity and we want solidarity. Oh, and by the way, it has not worked to say that, you know, if my neighbor has something that I don't have, that's unfair and we need to pull them down. Unfairness is when everything is pushing us down, not when we're pushing each other up. And so that's what we have to be doing. But, you know, the other thing, Nomiki, that hit me that I almost put out into the universe the other night, but I did not because, you know, everybody loves Michelle Obama and I understand why. So I didn't want it to be misunderstood. But the whole, you know, they go low, we go high thing. Yes, you know, we need to be for decency and respect and compassion for each other. And that's how we should be behaving. That's absolutely right. But that phrase, if we're thinking that that is some sort of leadership guidance for us, it is the problem. Because what that means is that we're letting the other side map the conversation.
Exactly.
And now we're responding rather than leading. And what we have to do is lead. So all we have to do is listen to the people and lead. And I think that is something that, you know, concerns me a little bit about the convention, frankly, is that we got to get that message out that we can actually lead. We don't have to respond all the time.
We started with a clip of Rahm Emanuel basically saying, all we need to do is be anti-Trump with another panelist, Yvette, was saying, no, we need to, we're in a pandemic, we have multiple crises, and we need solutions, and we need to excite voters to show up. But also, those voters need to be out there organizing to hold pressure, as you said, moving forward, because we've been here before. I mean, the Obama administration was this big hope, and we lost, I mean, especially unions. There was a huge privatization effort throughout the administration within the Democratic Party. So.
Huge privatization effort and some really bad work on trade. I mean, if we can change the thinking and help people understand that if you build from the ground up, you're so much stronger. There is no trickle down. There's no there's no effort to try to push things that way. People, the $600 plus up on the unemployment, that has kept 5 million jobs afloat because guess what? The people who are getting that $600 have no choice but to spend it because they don't have the money. They've got to spend it back into the economy. And what does that do? That supports other jobs. That's so right. Not reinstating the $600 is putting another 5 million jobs at risk. Right. And ironically, unemployment and a plus up on unemployment is an actual jobs program. And people need to start thinking about it that way. And Democrats need to be talking about it that way because that was a Democratic idea, right? And we need to be talking about the solutions that we're getting right now. People don't want to wait and they don't want to wait for promises and they don't just want to hear what you're against. That's a bunch of excuses. And by the way, don't tell me you support me. Tell me you're going to fight for me.
Love it. Sara Nelson, I want to sit and talk to you for hours and just listen to you. Fireside Chats with Sara Nelson. We can learn so much. You and Jane McAlevey should have a show together on power.
Oh, gosh, that would be, you know what? That would be really great.
We could do
great.
A segment. How about that? We'll do a segment on power.
You know what? Oh, love God. That. Love that. Bring Stacey Davis Gates on, too.
Yes. Yes. Oh, my God. People's minds will explode. Sara, thank you so much for everything you're doing. Best of luck. There's a lot on the table right now. You know, you're fighting the fight and you're doing the good work and we're watching closely and cheering you on. So thank you. Really appreciate
it. Thank you so much. Appreciate you. And of course, we love our matriarch.
Oh, yes. Sara is one of our advisors at Matriarch, the organization that we often talk about on this show, supporting working class women running for office. Cori Bush just won, so.
Yay, yes,
big,
yes.
Big win.
big win. Congratulations to all of us. Thank you, Nomiki. You're a wonderful leader. Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching and listening to The Nomiki Show. But remember to click like and subscribe on YouTube and please share on social media. If you're not already a patron, please join us for as low as $5 a month on patreon.com/TheNomiKiShow for early and special content. That investment makes a huge difference. We are not corporate media raking in the dough. It's really you guys that are keeping us going. So please consider being a patron. And to our current patrons, thank you so much. We are incredibly grateful to you. We also now have swag. So check us out on thenomikishow.com to get your mugs, your totes, and your stickers.